This is Mr. Hastavik's World History Online Lecture Number 3, The Fall of Napoleon and the Significance of the Congress of Vienna. 3 years after he had crowned himself the Emperor of France, Napoleon seemed poised to conquer all of Europe. Indeed, he had the mightiest of Europe's empires, England, Austria, Prussia, and Russia, deeply concerned for their own safety. Beginning in 1805, however, a series of costly mistakes, as well as a run of bad luck, would see Emperor Bonaparte fall from his power nearly as quickly as he rose to it. Napoleon's subsequent surrender would also usher in the necessity of having Europe's chief powers come together for the first time in over 150 years in order to design a peace that would have profound effects upon the map and the people of Europe, and would even help set in motion another, greater, and bloodier period of warfare nearly a century later, World War I. Napoleon's fall. By 1805, Napoleon had pounded Europe into submission. The nations of Spain, the Netherlands, Belgium, and most of Italy's city-states were either directly under Napoleon's control, or he had placed his own family members on the thrones of those territories in order to rule in his place. The Austrian and Prussian empires were either directly under Napoleon's influence or were his de facto allies, along with the kingdoms of Norway and Denmark. Napoleon's grip firmly controlled Western and Central Europe. Only the British Empire, with its mighty navy, and the Russian Empire, its vast, seemingly endless territory, a daunting obstacle even to the most advanced army, were able to maintain independence. In 1805, Napoleon would be dealt his first significant defeat in Europe. By 1805, he had constructed an enormous navy in the south of France with one singular purpose: invading England, France's century-old foe and rival for world power. Napoleon even sold off France's holdings in North America, the Louisiana Territory, to the young Republic of the United States in 1803 for roughly $15 million in order to help finance the construction of his navy. By the autumn of 1805, Napoleon had ordered some 33 of his most massive warships in the French and Spanish navies combined. Remember, Spain was conquered by Napoleon and his brother sat upon the Spanish throne, to hunt down and destroy the strongest ships in the British Navy. The British Navy, however, was prepared for the challenge, and 27 of its best warships, led by Admiral Horatio Nelson, met Napoleon's fleet off the south coast of Spain, near the Straits of Gibraltar. The Battle of Trafalgar on October 5, 1805, turned out to be a rout for the British. Her Majesty's fleet smashed 22 French and Spanish warships, two-thirds of Napoleon's fleet, without seeing one single British vessel sunk. Napoleon's navy was crushed, and with it, any hopes of ever invading England's shores. A French sniper, however, had mortally wounded Admiral Nelson. Lord Nelson, however, lived long enough to see his fleet defeat Napoleon's. His dying words were, "Thank God, I have done my duty." Nelson became England's greatest naval hero and remains an inspiration to the British Navy today. In London, there remains a massive tribute and memorial to Nelson in one of the city's busiest market zones, Trafalgar Square. His hopes of invading England now sunk forever at the bottom of the sea, Napoleon sought another means of destroying his English rivals. He developed the continental system as a means of choking England economically. Napoleon had a tight grip across Europe, and he now sought to exercise that grip by squeezing out all trade with England. Napoleon ordered every country in Europe to boycott the trade of British goods, and he blockaded those ports in Europe that he determined might still trade regardless. Both France and England harassed ships throughout the Atlantic whom they thought might trade with their enemy. Both the English and the French boarded American trading vessels on their way to the enemy's port and confiscated their cargoes. The British went so far as to force American crews to join the British Navy or face imprisonment in British jails. This practice of impressment would be one of the chief causes of the second war the Americans fought against the British in the War of 1812. Napoleon's economic strategy was only a partial success. While his continental system did hurt England economically, he had vastly underestimated that nation's willpower and self-reliance. In fact, because trade with Europe had been so restricted, England, as a result, had made dramatic improvements in its own ability to produce manufactured goods and agricultural goods that it could not get because trade with Europe was closed off. Napoleon had inadvertently helped jumpstart the Industrial Revolution in England, which would have tremendous consequences for that nation and the world throughout the next century. Russia, who was the farthest away from France of all European nations, and who was the most dependent upon imported goods, could hold out no longer. In 1812, the Russian Tsar, Alexander I, withdrew Russia from the continental system and began to trade with England once again. Napoleon had no choice but to prepare to fight the largest nation in the world. Napoleon pulled out all the stops in forming the army with which he hoped to subdue the Russians. His grand army was made up of over 600,000 soldiers from France and its allies. The world had never seen an army so massive. Surely the Russians could not withstand its might and would be brought to a quick submission. He sent the grand army eastward in mid-1812 to great fanfare as they marched under Paris' Arc de Triomphe. The Russians, however, were ready for such a challenge. Russia has been invaded dozens of times, both from the east and west historically, and while it had never been a mighty offensive power up to this point in history, Russia knew how to defend herself well, and it knew how to use its massively large territory to its advantage. Employing a strategy called slash and burn, even before Napoleon's Grand Army arrived, the Russians on the western end of the country began hastily retreating eastward. As they pulled back, they burned all their crops, killed their livestock, and destroyed their homes as they fled. Napoleon might be able to easily conquer this territory, but his troops would find no comfort or food waiting for him. His grand army would have to depend upon its supply lines from France, supply lines that were growing longer every day to keep them fed and provisioned. In September of 1812, the grand army entered Moscow, only to find it largely deserted. Additionally, Russians had employed guerrilla warfare, attacking straggling chunks of his army, and had reduced its numbers significantly by the time it entered Moscow. Further, dysentery, diphtheria, and other diseases, as well as hunger due to Russia's slash and burn strategy, had killed off even more members of the Grand Army and had effectively demoralized its troops. The army couldn't fight because the Russians would never present much of a target to fight with. Weather took a significant turn for the worse, as an early, extremely harsh winter fell. The Grand Army supply lines froze in their tracks and prohibited any food from making its way to the troops. In October, the Russians began mounting counterattacks against the French. With no supplies, disease, and the cold killing off thousands of troops daily, the French had no choice but to retreat back home unsuccessful. By the time what was left of the Grand Army had returned to France, only a quarter of its size, 150,000 troops, remained. Over 400,000 soldiers had died in this failed campaign, and now Napoleon was left without a mighty army to defend his European empire. Russia, England, Austria, and Prussia took advantage of Napoleon's loss and quickly formed an alliance. In 1813, at the Battle of Leipzig's Battle of the Nations, the Grand Alliance crushed what remained of Napoleon's army. In defeat, Napoleon abdicated his throne. He stepped down from ruling France and was exiled to the Mediterranean island of Elba. True to form, however, Napoleon in dramatic fashion escaped from his exile in 1815 and returned to passionate cheers in France. He took control of France's armed forces and once again threatened his neighbors with conquest. His victorious return was to be short-lived, however. The Grand Alliance met Napoleon on the battlefield once more in the Belgian territory of Waterloo, where Napoleon saw his reformed army utterly destroyed in a single day's work on June 18, 1815. Ever since that day, an utter and total disaster of a failure has always been referred to as a Waterloo. Napoleon was once again exiled, this time to a tiny, lonely little island of St. Helena in the Atlantic Ocean, where the twice-defeated French emperor would die in early 1821, allegedly of stomach cancer. However, modern investigations lead one to conclude that Napoleon may actually have been poisoned over a long period of time by arsenic. Perhaps some of his enemies feared that a third escape just might prove to be Napoleon's charm. Napoleon's defeat and death had almost as much an impact as he had in life. His efforts jump-started industrialization in England and had doubled the size of the United States, setting that country on a course of dramatic expansion and a rise to power in its own right. Further, Napoleon had left Europe in total chaos. His wars had caused tremendous disruption of trade and commerce. He had disrupted politics by kicking former rulers off their throne and placing his own family in their stead, such as he had done in Spain. Additionally, Napoleon spread many of the ideals of the French Revolution to countries around Europe, which had never known such liberties. Napoleon had instituted constitutions in nations that had never had them. Elections, even though only wealthy landowners got to vote, were held where democracy never existed. People under Napoleon's rule throughout Europe had greater opportunities for education and rising up in social and economic status than they had ever enjoyed before. Most importantly, Napoleon had stirred up feelings of nationalism, the sentiment that only a nation of unified people should rule itself, not an empire. That is, only Germans should rule Germany, not Prussia. Only Hungarians should rule Hungary, not Austria. Only Greeks should rule over Greece, not the Ottoman Empire. The Congress of Vienna. The Allied nations of Europe had come together not only to defeat Napoleon, but to clean up the mess he left behind. This they did, beginning even before Napoleon's second defeat at Waterloo in September of 1814. For 10 months, representatives from Russia, England, Austria, and Prussia met together in Austria's capital at Vienna to meet and plan out what would be the future of not only Europe, but the world. France was finally admitted to the Congress of Vienna after the frequent petitioning and political maneuvering of Charles Maurice de Talleyrand. His involvement, though minimalized in the Congress's formal proceedings, would be crucial to seeing that France was not punished severely for Napoleon's actions. The first and most urgent function of the Congress was to fix the map of Europe that Napoleon had altered so dramatically. In order to ensure that France would not be able to rise up and conquer so much so quickly, the Congress had bordered it with a strengthened Belgium and Netherlands, as well as the new nation of Luxembourg. Prussia gained lands along the Rhine River, right on France's western border. Austrian territory was expanded to the south and west as it absorbed northern Italian provinces such as Milan and Turin. France was now surrounded by mighty empires and buffer states that would help prevent any French conquests to the east. Further, France lost all of the territory that Napoleon had conquered. In redrawing the map in this manner, the Congress of Vienna had created a balance of power between the main empires of Austria, Russia, England, and Prussia. The Congress deemed that by maintaining the main European powers at a roughly equal level of strength, no one would be eager to press for war. Although there were many small skirmishes across Europe during the 1800s, the Congress was largely correct. It would be nearly 100 years before Europe saw as destructive and bloody a conflict as Napoleon's wars ever again. King Louis XVIII, Louis XVI's brother, was placed on the throne of France as its legitimate ruler by the Congress of Vienna. This was a significant act because by placing a king, let alone a blood relative of Louis XVI, on the throne of France, the Congress of Vienna in essence stated not only that monarchy was the only legitimate form of government in France, if not Europe, but all the French Revolution had toiled and fought for was, in essence, meaningless. The Congress of Vienna refused to recognize any of the advances that the Revolution made in terms of human rights or people's right to have a say in their own government. This made the Congress of Vienna at its heart a very conservative decision-making body. Because it advanced the legitimacy of the pre-revolution institutions and governments and refused to acknowledge the newer, more liberal, and enlightened political ideals that had not only swept over France 2 decades earlier, but thanks to Napoleon, were now sweeping over the rest of Europe. In this last effort at making monarchy the legitimate form of government in Europe, the Congress of Vienna would only temporarily be successful. The cry for democracy and self-rule among the nations who had been absorbed into the Russian, Austrian, and Prussian empires was too strong to stifle for long. France itself went through a series of revolutions against monarchies in 1830, 1848, and again in 1872, establishing the second, third, and fourth French republics after each. Austria and Prussia were both challenged by their German territories, who cried for self-rule and national German unity in a massive uprising in 1848. The Magyars, the largest and most powerful of the Hungarian ethnicities under the rule of the Austrian Empire, threatened to tear that empire apart with civil war until Austria offered them additional rule and power in the newly reformed Austrian-Hungarian Empire. Italian nationalists like Garibaldi and Mazzini began to lay the groundwork for the unification of all the Italian-speaking territories into one solid nation before the 1800s would draw to a close. Only England seemed to find relative peace and prosperity at this time, and largely for two reasons. First, its government was already somewhat democratic because of Parliament's existence. While most British men could not vote for their representatives in Parliament, they found enough allies in the government to gradually increase the number of men who could vote so that the country did not ultimately dissolve into civil war. Additionally, the balance of power suited England's needs as a naval power and the world's largest colonial power. With peace across the continent, trade around the world exploded, and England was right in the middle of that trade and was able to take advantage of Europe's demands for goods from India, China, Africa, and the Americas. England saw its national wealth multiply many times over during the 1800s as its industrial revolution continued to grow. In short, the balance of power created by the Congress of Vienna allowed England to become the largest empire in the world, the wealthiest nation in the world, and the most dominant naval power in the world. As much as Waterloo had firmly closed the chapter on the bloody and tumultuous French Revolution, the Congress of Vienna opened a new era in Europe. This era would be defined as much by nationalism in Europe as it would by colonization and conquest of Africa and Asia. Industry and commerce would be the source of economic and political, and therefore military power in the 19th century. A century in which England would dominate, but also one in which its former colony, abandoned to its own experiment with democracy and self-rule on the other side of the world, would soon catch up.